Hey travelers, Mag and I here on day 321 of our trip around the United States. I've done all the big things that you're supposed to do when you're out here in the Seattle area. I've gone to GCD, Washington's oldest. I've been to the original Stash tribute plaque, and we've also made the trek out to get the ape cache. But when we did that, we took the short way. Now, we're going to do something I've wanted to do for well over a decade now, and walk through the Tunnel of Light to get to Iron Horse on the other side. Knowing the pace Aichan takes, we're gonna set aside the entire day to do this adventure. We may finish a little bit earlier, but we're gonna let her walk the speed she wants, and when she gets tired, she's going up in the backpack, and we're gonna hike her in from there. With what we have left of today and tomorrow, we're gonna finish that route we have going east through the center of Washington. We'll swing in towards Seattle to add our names to the Lorem Challenge Final, and from there, we'll be heading east pretty much all day long to bring our day to an end in Creston. Looking forward to being able to finally make it to the other side of the Tunnel of Light. So let's see, or not see, what the tunnel and beyond has in store for us. Come on, let's go. To access the nearly 2 mile long Tunnel of Light, we begin our day at Iron Horse State Park. The trail leading from this park and through the tunnel is part of the 250 mile long Palouse to Cascade State Park trail system. It is only about a third of a mile from the parking area to the tunnel entrance, where we can immediately feel the cool breeze funneling out of the tunnel toward us. Despite the fact that the cave is a man-made tunnel constructed to allow trains to pass through the mountain, it still functions much the same as a natural cave would. It remains consistently cool inside all year long.
It is pitch black in this tunnel. We can see the light dimming behind us, and a pinprick of light out in the distance, slowly, ever so slowly, gets bigger.
The tiny prick of light ahead of us is the only view we have of the trail moving forward.
This is quite a long way to walk in the dark like this. Very interesting experience.
Aichan had no desire to stop and take in the smells here. She just kept moving as quickly as she could toward the light ahead of us.
If you are brave enough to face the oppressive darkness, Tunnel of Light, there is an ammo can to be found somewhere along the way.
If Aichan wasn't already freaked out, I think my maniacal laughing is what finally pushed her right over the edge.
The flashlight does absolutely nothing to illuminate anything in the tunnel except the area just immediately around you. Anything beyond that, the darkness just eats it alive.
By this point, Aichan seems to be in total disbelief that a trail like this would even exist in the first place.
Gradually, oh so gradually, this has grown from a little pinprick of light to the actual shape of a tunnel door. I still feel like we're a long way off, but there is a light at the end of the tunnel.
And Aichan remains focused on that light like it's her only means of escape.
We can see details of the tunnel now. I think I see the shape of a tree out the other side. Aichan's getting really excited and starting to get her step moving.
It's such a weird experience to see the light growing larger, but still seems so far away. And then, seemingly all at once, the light begins to grow bright along the tunnel walls around us, and we know we have made it to the other side. As Aichan takes her first tentative steps out of the tunnel, it's easy to see that she is surprised and elated that we actually made it out. From here, it's just a matter of tracking down Iron Horse, the prize that we came out here seeking. The posted coordinates put us very near the tunnel entrance, so we stick pretty close to that as our ground zero and begin to work our way around and up. Just above the tunnel entrance, we discover this waterfall careening down the rocks and emerging on the other side. From the top, it only takes us a couple of minutes to spot the prize we came here seeking.
Well, we did it. We managed to make it through 2 miles of darkness, moving through the Tunnel of Light. They really should call it the Tunnel of Darkness, because that light is just a pinprick for almost that entire journey until you finally get there. Aichan was cooking through the tunnel. She wasn't interested in stopping for the smells. She was just interested on that light at the end of that thing and making it all the way through. On our journey through there, we did find the highly favorited Bloody Fingers and Dirty Diapers geocache, and I was doing a very poor job of counting. Fortunately, the description gives you a pretty good idea where to look where you get there in the tunnel, and when I got to the right spot, even though my number was off, I still hit it. Coming out the tunnel from the other side, We managed to get Iron Horse, and that's it. We've made it through the tunnel of light. Now it's time to turn right back around and head back. Aichun's exhausted. She put all of her energy into making it through the tunnel on a beeline. I'm gonna go ahead and transport her easy way back to the other side of that tunnel, and then I'll let her down once we get there. 2 miles, here we go.
As soon as I showed her what I wanted to do, she came right over and laid down in the bag. Now it's just a matter of getting her in here nice and comfortable so she can take the easy way back through the tunnel of light.
The hardest part of using the doggy backpack for Aichun is getting her up on my back by myself. With a little bit of assistance, this is a pretty easy task, but alone, it takes a lot of balance to be able to get up with that weight pulling you back down at an awkward angle, especially with paws poking you in the neck.
Okay, here we go. Back into the tunnel of light. I think Aichun is all down for this adventure in the high seats.
Making the return trip back into the tunnel of light is a cinch compared to making the original trip in. At least this time, we know exactly what we're dealing with. Cold air, a dripping ceiling, puddles on the ground, and complete darkness.
We are going to make phenomenal time on the way back compared to the way there. Assuming Aichun allows me to take her all the way. It's possible in the middle of the tunnel, she may tell me that she's all done with the ride. But I suspect not. She really didn't seem to like it in there. The only reason she was moving so fast is because she could see the light at the other end and wanted to get out. Who's a good girl? Yeah, who's a good girl like Jen?
No more than a few feet from the entrance, the eerie sounds of the tunnel drowned out the noise from the outside world.
Here we go. That light's fading away quickly. Last glances, Aichun. Going back in the darkness again. Yep. We'll be in and out in no time at all.
Despite the power of my flashlights, I can't help but be shocked at how ineffective they are in here.
How we doing, Aichun? You having fun up there? Still better than walking, right? Yeah, definitely beats walking through this darkness. We'll get there lickety-split, Aichun.
Aichun silently watches the light at the far end of the tunnel, hoping that we'll get there soon.
That's it, mission success. We have made it 4 miles and some change round trip through the tunnel of light to find Iron Horse and had a great time out here at Snoqualmie Pass. Aichun did not move the entire time we were in the tunnel except to shift position. She did not want me to mistake her intent to get down because she did not want to walk that tunnel again. You did great, Aichun.
Making it through the tunnel of light with some time to spare for the day, we next decide to stop off at Snoqualmie Falls just up the road. These majestic falls, taking their 270-foot plunge over the edge, are one of the most scenic attractions in the state, bringing in more than 1.5 million visitors every single year. The 2-acre park here features both an upper and lower observation deck, providing multiple viewpoints from which to enjoy nature's scenic show. With the last of our remaining time available for the day, we make a trek into Soaring Eagle Park in pursuit of the Washington DeLorme Challenge Final. This 600-acre park, sitting above Patterson Creek on the edge of the Sammamish Plateau on the western flank of the Snoqualmie River Valley, features 12 miles of hiking trails. Fortunately, we didn't need to go nearly that far to reach our goal because that would have been a non-starter conversation with a dog after completing the tunnel of light. Instead, we only had to hike about a third of a mile out and then back again, which is just as much energy as we have left in reserve. As with any time that we find ourselves walking through the woods, we know that the experience just wouldn't be the same without jumping off the trail for a minute and tracking down a few caches. And while I am not above hunting for a micro in the woods, as I like finding geocaches in general, I must admit that getting to discover ammo cans is always the best case scenario for me. It's great to see that that seems to be the norm out here, rather than the exception to the rule. After a good night's sleep to rest our weary paws, we begin our next day in the Bavarian village of Leavenworth. This small city in Chelan County, with a population of about 2,200 people, is very unique in that it is modeled after a German Bavarian village. Founded on September 5th of 1906, this city saw its beginnings as a result of the construction of the Great Northern Railway through the Tumwater Canyon. Serving as a regional office for the railway, Leavenworth experienced rapid growth as a timber community, right up until the railroad relocated to Wenatchee in 1925. That move sent the local economy into a tailspin, which, for many other communities, was the transition point to becoming a ghost town, but not for Leavenworth. Rather than giving up in the face of changing times, they too changed with the times. The remaining residents of the city immediately began to shift their focus on providing tourism and recreation for travelers. Their efforts met with little success until in 1962, in partnership with the University of Washington, Project Life was formed.
Short for Leavenworth Improvement for Everyone, the members of Project Life investigated ways to revitalize the struggling economy in the town and came up with the idea of the theme. The first building to be remodeled was the Chickaman Hotel, then renamed the Edelweiss after the state flower of Bavaria. Other buildings began to follow suit until eventually the entire town had been converted into a Bavarian village. That, by itself, was not enough to affect the change that they desired, so the community leaders also came up with a series of festivals to bring people to the area, beginning with the Autumn Leaf Festival and the Christmas Lighting Festival. Now, this little Bavarian village in the Pacific Northwest holds festivals pretty much every month, attracting more than 1 million visitors every year.
Finally, a hotel that really speaks to me. The Wanderlust. Do you feel it too?
Still in Chelan County, not too far down the road from Leavenworth, we come across the small city of Cashmere with a population of about 3,200 people. First known as Mission, it was renamed as Cashmere in 1904 to avoid confusion with another town that faded away with time. The one thing we were absolutely not going to miss in this city was the 9/11 Spirit of America Memorial. The four life-size statues in the center, holding hands, represent the various professions that lost personnel that day, with one missing spot for the victims who were never recovered.
The closer we look at this memorial, the more we discover, including a rock from the field where Flight 93 crashed, a metal beam recovered from the crash site in New York, and of course, the twin granite towers standing at nearly 11 feet tall, bearing the names of every single person who perished in New York during the attack. As we continue to get further from this tragic day, I find memorials like this to be of ever-increasing importance, both to keep alive the memory of those lost and to remind us of what we can achieve when we band together. As we make our way through these cities this morning, we are challenged by a series of rather creatively hidden geocaches. Aichan did her best to help me sniff these out of hiding, but as tired as she was from our hiking yesterday, I was on my own for most of these. Thankfully, even without her keen sense of smell to guide the way, I can still sniff out an ammo can when I arrive at Ground Zero. Coming down out of the mountains, we prepare ourselves to see the world's greatest waterfall, or at least what was once the world's greatest waterfall, at the Dry Falls Visitor Center. Near the end of the last ice age, the skeletal cliffs visible from this area once bore witness to catastrophic floods that swept over eastern Washington. The immensely powerful, erosive action of the floodwaters resulted in this canyon being carved out as the falls retreated further upstream. By the time they had finished carving out their path of geological destruction, the waterfall had moved 15 miles upstream from Soap Lake to Dry Falls, creating the Lower Grand Coulee. At the confluences for the Columbia River and the Spokane Rivers, we come across the old Army frontier outpost, Fort Spokane. Founded in the fall of 1880 by Lieutenant Colonel Henry Merriam, Fort Spokane served the purpose of separating the Colville and Spokane tribes on their reservations from the newly established city of Spokane. At its peak, the fort was comprised of around 50 buildings, including an officer's quarter, enlisted men's barracks, hospital, chapel, post headquarters, shops, stables, and even a trader store. The fort saw use until 1929, when it was incorporated into the Lake Roosevelt National Recreation Area. With our day quickly approaching its end, we slide through Stevens County in the city of Chihuahua, with a population of about 2,500 people. This small town led the way with a number of firsts for Stevens County, with the first school in 1869, the first county newspaper in 1885, and the first Protestant Congregational Church in 1891. A beautiful spot for both Aichan and I to settle down for a little bit and catch our breath before the next step.
Okay, that's gonna do it for our 2 days spent moving from west to east, right across the center of the state of Washington. We began yesterday morning out at Snoqualmie Pass, and I'd sliced off just that portion of the day, assuming that it would take Aichan and I pretty much all day long, and you know what? It did. To hike the 2+ miles all the way through the tunnel, and then hike it back. Of course, hiking back, we made about half the time we did on the way there, because Aichan rode in the backpack, and that made all the difference. By the time we got out to the DeLorme Challenge, not too far outside of Seattle, she looked at me like I was crazy for wanting her to do a third of a mile. She got up, she did it, and that was it for our day. Rest and relaxation from there. When we woke up this morning, we started covering down on our miles, heading east all day long. When we got into Creston, which was supposed to be the end of our day's route, we were still several hours ahead. So we decided to push all the way through the next day's route as well, which had us covering 110 miles from Creston all the way into Spokane. Now the thing is, Spokane was always an additional day for us. We'd already been through Spokane with Inextricable Fate on a previous trip, and the only reason it made the list is because I love the city. I think it is awesome. However, the best way to experience Spokane is to get out there and walk those streets, and that's something I don't want to make Aichun do unless absolutely necessary, and it is not. So we are going to cut that day. Tomorrow is my birthday, and my birthday gift to myself, and by extension to Aichun, is that we are going to take the entire day off. When we'd skipped out on Spokane, I was really hoping we might come across one of those small city parks where we can park for the day, pay a small fee, and relax. And when we got here in Chihuahua, that's exactly what we found. It is a beautiful town, and our little RV spot has the river running right between us for the night. We've got great acoustics there, beautiful view of the greenery, and within walking distance of us, we've got several places to go grab some food tomorrow as well. So we're gonna take the whole day off, rest, relax, and most importantly, catch up on those videos I've been putting off and putting off. We will be ready to have a paradigm shift when we get back on the road the day after tomorrow from the very northeast corner of Washington. But until then, thank you guys for joining us as we continue to tour through the state. Like this video, subscribe, stay tuned for updates, and we'll see you out on the trails.